Department of Brain and Cognitive Science at MIT, working with Sebastian Shen. Sebastian Sun. He received his bachelor degree in physics and PhD degree in computational neuroscience from Hebrew University in Jerusalem, working with Haim Sopolansky from Racha Institute of Physics and Yosef Yalom from Department of Neurobiology. My pronunciation is wrong, maybe. He got the award. He award is Rothschild Fellow, Horowitz Fellow, and the winner of the Wolf Prize for graduate students and the Shalomik Prize for postdoctoral studies. Great. The one special thing about him is that he was a summer course student 4 years ago already. And at that time, he presented poster at the poster session, and I heard first time of his study about the computational modeling of bistability in the cerebellum. And I was impressed. And then I found the papers published, came out last year, right? So I decided to invite him. So you will have a chance in near future. Okay, so Yonatan, thank you very much for coming.
Do you have a microphone? You need a microphone because other people look. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a real pleasure to be here for the second time. Indeed, I was a student here 4 years ago. It was really fun. And maybe you'll also come 4 years from now. I'm going to talk about cellular bistability in the cerebellum. This is the cerebellum. Is it possible to have a point in this pointer? This is one volume in the cerebellum. This is just an illustration of this volume. And I'm interested in these really beautiful cells, which are known as Purkinje cells. These cells receive two types of input. One from the inferior olive. This is a single axon that wraps around the soma and the proximal dendrite of this cell, which is known as the climbing fiber. And the other type of input, well, there are actually about 10 to the 5 to 10 to the 6 of these inputs. These are the parallel fibers that go through the dendritic arbor of the Purkinje cells, making a single synapse. This is just a beautiful illustration by Ramon y Cajal about 100 years ago. When people started recording the extracellular activity of these cells about 50 years ago, they found that these cells display two types of characteristic discharge patterns. There are these spikes, these short spikes that occur at a pretty high rate, about 50 hertz. And there are these spikes that occur, the time scale of these spikes is much longer, but they occur at a much lower rate, about 1 hertz, once a second. This is how these events look like when you record intracellularly from these cells. This is just regular Hodgkin-Huxley-like action potential, whereas these events are prolonged events. Look at the time scale. There is a slow depolarization. It's known that there is calcium entry. And on top of this depolarization, there are several inactivating sodium spikes. And it is well established that these events, the complex spikes, originate from the input that arrives from the inferior olive, from the climbing fibers. So every action potential that propagates through the climbing fibers generates a single complex spike, a single event of this type. And it is commonly believed that these events, the simple spikes, originate from the input that's coming from the parallel fibers. And in this talk, I will try to convince you that this is not the case, that simple spike activity in Purkinje cells is intrinsic. It does not depend on this synaptic input from the parallel fibers. That the dynamics of Purkinje cells is bistable. I will show how this dynamics is, how this bistability is controlled by climbing fibers input. I will show the effect of sensory stimulation. Then I will talk about a possible mechanism for the bistability of Purkinje cells. And if I have time, I will try to connect it to other bistable systems in the brain. For example, binocular rivalry can be viewed as bistable dynamics. Please interrupt at any point in time to ask questions. If you're unhappy about my answers, just throw something. As long as you don't hit my laptop, it's okay. This is an example of intracellular recording from a Purkinje cell in vivo. And what you see is that the cell alternates from being in a hyperpolarized quiescent state to and a depolarized spiking state. The fact that there are two states here is illustrated in the histogram of the membrane potential. This is the histogram of the membrane potential. This histogram is bimodal. This peak corresponds to the times when the cell is hyperpolarized, whereas this peak corresponds to the time, to the times in which the cell is depolarized. This bimodality of the membrane potential of the cell is very robust. We see it in rats, we see it in all cells in which we record from. In this case, this is a rat anesthetized with ketamine. We can change the anesthesia. We see a very similar pattern of activity. Again, by, sorry? Yeah. These, no, these are, most of them are simple spikes. But sometimes there are very few, if any, spikes in the up state. You don't need spikes in order to have a depolarized state. But still the membrane potential is bimodal. So this bimodality is not dependent on spiking activity. These were rats. Now just an example from a guinea pig, again, bimodality, and today there are other labs that are studying this phenomenon, and people have seen it in also in anesthetized mice. This is a lab of Chris de Zeeuw in the Netherlands. You don't need to, in fact, you don't need to record intracellularly from these cells in order to see this bimodality. This is an example of extracellular recording, and as you can see, there are times in which the cell spikes at a very high rate, and there are other times where the spiking is at a very low rate. These are, in fact, complex spikes. And if it's a very good question. This is a topic of controversy, and I will go back to it shortly later in my talk. What I'm plotting here is a histogram of the instantaneous firing rate of this cell. And as you can see, it's bimodal. There's a peak in zero corresponding to these times where there's no simple spike activity. And there's a peak around 100 hertz, which corresponds to the times in which these cells spike. I mean, to the times in which you see these simple spikes. What mechanism underlies this bimodality? In principle, there can be two possibilities. Either that the input is bimodal, and the activity in Purkinje cells just reflects this input. This is one possibility. The other possibility that there's nothing interesting in the input. This is just an illustration of, I don't know, a histogram of the input. And this bimodality results from the intrinsic properties of the Purkinje cells. So these are, in principle, the two possibilities. And I will try to convince you that the bimodal distribution of the membrane potential that we observe results from the bistable dynamics of the membrane potential of these cells. So what do I mean by bistable? I don't know how much you know about by stable systems, I will try to give you the intuition of what I mean by stability. So this will be what I will call a non-bistable cell. What I'm plotting here is the membrane potential of the cell as a function, or if you like, the firing rate of the cell as a function of the input, and it has there's a one curve, one monotonous curve. This is what you will see, for example, if you record from pyramidal cells in the cerebral cortex. So the idea that, one possibility is that the input is bimodal, that is sometimes you have input at this level and sometimes you have input at this level, and also, and therefore the output is bimodal. Sometimes this is the output of the cell and sometimes this is the output of the cell. So the input is bimodal and therefore the output of the cell is bimodal. This is one possibility. The other possibility is that the cell is bistable, and I'll try to explain what I mean by that. So you the idea is that you take a cell, you increase the current that you inject to this cell, the membrane potential increases, and then there is a jump to a higher state. But when you decrease the current from here, it doesn't go through the same path. It starts from higher response or higher membrane potential and goes down only here. This phenomenon is known in physics or in engineering as hysteresis. And the idea will be that the input has, there is one input to the cell at this value, but the output of the cell sometimes is along this branch and sometimes is along this branch. So the input is unimodal, but the output is bimodal. So this is the second possibility, the second possible mechanism for the bimodality that we observe. Mechanical or everyday illustration to these two types of behavior, the response of the engine of a car to pressing the gas pedal is I would call it a non-bistable, a unistable response, because the number of cycles per second of the engine is just proportional to the amount of pressure you exert on this pedal. Whereas a switch is a bistable element. So you start exerting force here, nothing happens. When the force is strong enough, then it jumps to this state. And now you start exerting negative pressure, nothing happens. When the force is strong enough, then it goes back to the down state. So this is an example of a bistable system, and this is an example of a non-bistable system. Is it clear? So the firing of complex spikes by the cell is known to result from the input. It's a transient response to transient input from the inferior olive. Did I answer your question? Okay, so maybe I should go back to the. So there are two types of, there are two things that one can look at. One can look at the membrane potential, and one can look at the, well, actually, they're more or less the same thing. But one, when people record extracellularly, they look at the discharge pattern. And these cells are unique in that they have two types of discharge pattern. One is called complex spike, and one is called simple spike. I think this is the only example in the central nervous system where one can distinguish extracellularly between different inputs to the cell. So it is believed that this input generates these, or it's known, I think it's well established that this input generates these events. Now the question is what generates these events? And my claim is that these events are intrinsic to the cell. I will go back to the complex later on. But for the time being, I'm only interested in the simple spikes. Or even in the membrane potential per se when the cell is not spiking, because we see bistability even in the absence of any spiking. Okay, so let's look at the input to the cells. So these cells receive, as I said, two types of input, one from the inferior olive, but this is input that is about once every second. It's not, so it's not relevant for the time scale that we're talking about, so I'll ignore it for the time being. The second input is from the parallel fibers, and there are two parallel fibers originate in these cells known as the granular cells. By the way, most of the neurons in your brain are granular cells, so don't ignore them. So one can record from the granular cells and also from the inhibitory neurons in the molecular layer of the cortex, and there's nothing bimodal about the activity of these cells. So it doesn't seem that the input to the Purkinje cells is bimodal. Another thing that one can do is to take, we're doing intracellular recording, so we can take this cell and hyperpolarize it and see what will happen. So this cell is bimodal. When we hyperpolarize it, it becomes unimodal. And this is consistent with what we would expect from a bistable element. So let's think of a unistable cell that receives bimodal input. We hyperpolarize it. The output also is also bimodal, but at different levels. Whereas a bistable element, if this is the input, and the output and the bimodality in the output results from the bistability of the cell, if we hyperpolarize it sufficiently, then it will become a unimodal cell. And this is what we see here. Hyperpolarization makes the cell unimodal. So this is consistent with the fact that what the bimodality that we observe is a result of bistability of the cell. Another way to check bistability is to induce transitions from down to up or from up to down, and we do it by transient current pulses. So initially the cell is in a down state, we inject depolarizing current pulse and jumps to an up state. Here it is initially in up state, high polarizing current pulse, and it jumps to a down state. So this will correspond to, we transiently depolarize the cell, it jumps to this state and then stays here. We high polarize it transiently, we release the hyperpolarization, it jumps to this state. This bistability is not seen only in vivo, but also in vitro. This is an example of in vitro recording, and we induce transitions from up to down, from down to up, with transient current pulses. So these cells are bistable. The next question is, how does the climbing fiber input, the input from the inferior olive, interact with the two states of the Purkinje cell? And in order to address this question, we recorded from Purkinje cells in sagittal slices. These are slices cut along this direction. So what we do, we electrically stimulate the climbing fiber. So we generate artificial complex spikes while recording from these Purkinje cells. And then the results of these experiments are presented here. So the triangles are times of climbing fiber stimulation, the generation of artificial complex spikes. The cell is initially in a down state. Climbing fiber, artificial climbing fiber input generates a complex spike and a transition to an up state. Another one, transition to a down state. Another one, up state. Another one, down state. And so on and so forth. This is just zooming into two of these transitions. Initially, it is in a down state, stimulating these fibers, generating an artificial complex spike, and a transition to up, to an up state. Initially in an up state, stimulating the climbing fibers, complex spike, and a transition to a down state. So the same input generates, the same synaptic input generates both transitions. This was in vitro. What happens in vivo? This is an example of what we call spontaneous transitions in vivo. So initially the cell is in a down state, and then we see a gradual transition to an up state. Or initially the cell is in an up state, and we see a gradual transition in a down state. But this is the minority of the cases. But for this cell, about 10% of the transitions. Usually, about 90% of the transitions are preceded by a spontaneous complex spike. So the cell was in a down state, there's a complex spike. We don't control it. This is in vivo. So we don't control the timing of the complex spike, but then there is a transition to an up state. And similarly here, the cell is in an up state, a complex spike, and a transition to a down state. This was one cell, and this will be the behavior across the population. If you are really interested in it, you'd like to know four numbers. Okay, So one number that you'd like to know is, what is the probability that a complex spike happening in a down state will induce a transition to an up state? What is the probability that a complex spike happening in an up state will induce a transition to a down state? And another question that you would like an answer to is, what is the probability that a transition to up was preceded or was generated by a complex spike? And what is the probability that a transition to down was preceded by a complex spike or was generated by climbing fiber input? And these are the numbers across the population. All I want to say is that most transitions are preceded by a complex spike, and most complex spikes are followed by a transition. So the efficiency is very high. So we have a bistable system in which the same input, the same synaptic input, induces transitions in both directions. And this reminds us of electronic devices. In electronic devices, a bistable element, a switch, in which the same input induces transitions in both directions is known as a toggle switch. So an example of a toggle switch will be a caps lock in the keyboard, because it's a bistable element. It can be in two states, either on or off. You press it once, everything you write is capital letters. Until you press it again, everything will be lowercase. You press it again, it will be upper capital letters, and so on and so forth. So caps lock is an example of a toggle switch. So for those of you who believe that the brain is a computer, I think we found the neural correlate of the caps lock in the keyboard. So far, we only discussed spontaneous input. And these are anesthetized animals. To become more biological, we looked at the effect of sensory evoked response of the Purkinje cells. And the experiment was the following. We recorded the activity of Purkinje cells, and we stimulated the whiskers of the rat by an air puff. And these raster plots are the results of these are 30 repetitions. These bars are the times of simple spikes, and these circles are the times of complex spikes. First thing, what I want you to notice is that in most cases, a complex spike was not evoked. I think a complex spike was evoked in about a third of our trials. So let's concentrate on just on these trials in which a complex spike was not evoked, the majority of the trials, about two-thirds. And we look at the modulation of simple spike activity. This is one example. There's air puff stimulation, and nothing happens to the simple spike activity. If we look at the histogram across the all repetitions, there's a very small modulation of simple spike activity as a result of the air puff. What about trials in which complex spikes were evoked? Well, sometimes they were evoked. Sometimes they were evoked when, let's see if I have a good example. Sometimes they were evoked when when the firing activity of a cell was in an up state, like this example. And in most of the cases, a complex spike resulted in a transition to a down state. This is illustrated here. This is a single example, and this is a histogram of all cases where a complex spike happened in an up state. Sometimes a complex spike happened in a down state. And in most cases, this complex spike induced a transition to an up state. This is a single example, and this is a histogram. And there was a minority of cases in which a complex spike, either in an up state or in a down state, did not induce a transition. And the result from this experiment is that, at least under these conditions, the sensory-evoked changes in simple spike activity are primarily due to the state transition that it was triggered by the activation of the climbing fiber input and the generation of the complex spike. The next question that we asked is whether the ability to induce transition transitions in both directions, whether there's something special about the climbing fiber input or something special about the complex spike that enables this bidirectional transition. And the answer is no, there's nothing mysterious about the climbing fiber input. This is an example of bidirectional transition with high polarizing current pulses. So initially the cell is in a down state, high polarizing current pulse induces a transition to an up state, another pulse a transition to down, another one transition to up, and so on and so forth. So outward current pulses can also induce transitions in both directions. So these are complex spikes. So the next question is about the mechanism. What is the underlying mechanism for this toggling phenomenon? And for this, a model is useful, and the model should capture the following phenomena. First, it should reproduce by stability. Second, we need toggling, and we've seen toggling by transient outward current pulses, and also toggling by climbing fiber input. So what is climbing fiber input? Climbing fiber input is our short events with very high sodium conductance. This is what we know about what happens maybe I should go back to. Yeah, so sometimes the cell fires constantly during the up state. Sometimes it fires and then stops and then fires and then stops. And sometimes it just fires one or two spikes and then stops altogether. And we see the same thing in, this is in vivo, but we see the same type of behavior also in vitro. And I don't know why. Does not depend on the, we see it in all types of anesthesia. One criticism that we received is that these are examples of cells which are not healthy. I disagree for the following reasons. One, we had a cell like this held for almost 2 hours in patch clamp in vivo. And the reason that it died is that I accidentally killed it. It didn't die naturally. We see it in vitro. We kind of see similar things in the pattern of activity recording extracellularly. Therefore, I don't believe that it reflects cells being unhealthy, but I don't have an answer. Yes? To not be compatible with these experiments. Yeah. I think that the spiking mechanism is something which is unrelated to the bistability. So one thing in vitro, temperature is a factor. So in room temperature, you are more likely to see non-spiking cells in an up state, but still you'll see the bistability. So they induce transition from up to down, yes. The answer is in vitro, you'll see the cell doesn't fire forever. We don't fire forever, we die. So this is a very, very important point, because when I'm saying by stability, I don't mean that the upstate lasts forever or that the downstate lasts forever, because nothing lasts forever in biology. What I mean is that the time scales of spontaneous transitions between the states are much longer than the time scales which are associated with these transitions, and I think also with the time scales, with the biological time scales. So if you, I will show an example later. Spontaneous transitions in vitro are happening on time scales of many tens of seconds, whereas with simple spike, but no triggering by anything, you'll see transitions on the time scale of tens of seconds. You don't see these time scales, you rarely see these time scales in vivo. So I'm not sure how important or how relevant it is for computation. But yes, there are transitions, but on a much longer time scale. Yes. So the experimental results are that you can do it either way. So you can induce transition from down to up with depolarization, and from up to down with hyperpolarization. And I think that this is a less surprising result. This is something that we know from this is something that we would naively expect from a bistable from a dynamical system of this kind. In addition to these transitions, we can also induce transitions, for example, from down to up by hyperpolarizing the cell. And the next topic that I wanted to address is the mechanism, try to explain how come. Yeah. You get the same thing by, you can hyperpolarize it, it will go to up, and you can depolarize it, and it will go to up. And I will try to explain how come. Okay, we need a model. And I will try to be slow here and stop. Just interrupt me, because I think that for some of you that are not familiar with dynamical systems, this will be, the following slides might be a little bit heavy. So we need a model, and we want to capture the following phenomena, the bistability, and the toggling by the outward current pulses and by the climbing fiber input. So what is a simple model for bistability? This is like, I think, the simplest model one can come up with. This is a single compartment model of a neuron that has just two currents, a leak current, so this is a leak current, a passive current, and a persistent inward current. For example, a persistent sodium current. So this is a persistent inward current. And what is the idea behind, this is an instantaneous persistent inward current. The idea is the following. When the cell is hyperpolarized, let's say here, this activation term of the persistent sodium current is around zero, so we shouldn't care about this current. And the resting potential of the cell is just the leak resting potential. Okay? When we depolarize the cell, this activation term, let's say, it goes to one. So we have two currents. We have a leak current, and we have a sodium current. And the resting potential will be just a combination of the leak current and the sodium current, depending on the exact values of the leak conductance and the sodium conductance. So this is a very simple model for bistability. Is the model clear? Any questions about the model? And one can show that this model is sufficient to explain the bistability, but it's not sufficient to explain the toggling, the fact that the same input induces both transitions. In order to understand what causes these transitions, it's useful to look at the, go back to the data. Well, it's always useful to go back to the data. This is an example of in vitro recording, and This is an example where there are no spikes at all in the upstate. Well, actually, there's one here. And we induce a transition from up to down with a hyperpolarizing current path. This is not very surprising. What happens when we hyperpolarize the cell while it is in a down state? So we hyperpolarize the cell while it is hyperpolarized. And when this hyperpolarization current is terminated, there is a rebound current. And after the rebound, there is a transition to up. So in order to understand the toggling, we need a rebound current. And a likely candidate for rebound current is an H current. And this is an example of recording with a much smaller hyperpolarizing current pulse. And this sag is characteristic, and this bump here are both characteristic of an H current. And when we block H current, the sag and the rebound disappear. So there's H current in these cells. So what is H current? H current is an inward current. It depolarizes the cells. It's a slowly inactivating current. So when the cell is hyperpolarized, it is open. When the cell is depolarized, it is closed. And this is a slow current. So we add this current, and it has a slow inactivation term. And there's another, now we have another dynamic variable. We have the inactivation term as a dynamic variable. And these two currents, in this very simple model, are sufficient to reproduce both the bistability and the bidirectional transitions, both with a complex spike, which we model with a fast high sodium conductance and hyperpolarizing current pulses. So we have a very simple model that captures the fundamental features, or at least the fundamental features for us, of these Purkinje cells. Since the model is so simple, we can try and understand the intuition behind this model. I think that John Rinzel described phase plane analysis. Am I correct? Okay, so what I'm doing here is following the footsteps of John Rinzel. I will explain the dynamics with a very using phase plane analysis. So we have, this is our model. The model has two dynamic variables, membrane potential and inactivation of the H current. There are three currents here. There's a leak current, persistent sodium, and the H current. And the state of the cell at each point in time can be described as a point in this HV phase plane. The first thing to look at is the null cline. So the first null cline is the line for which the HDT is equal to zero. So all these points along this line are points for which the HDT is equal to zero. So the HDT is equal to zero, which means H infinity of V is equal to H. So this is just the part of the inactivation curve of the H current. This is the first null cline. And we can do the same thing for the second null cline. The null cline for dVdt is equal to zero. This is the second null cline. And these three points, the intersection of the two null clines, are known as the fixed points. So if the dynamic starts from any point along these three fixed points, then the dynamics doesn't change. So the cell stays exactly the same. One can show that these two fixed points are stable, whereas this fixed point is unstable. The next thing to look at is the separatrix, the line that separates the two basins of attractions of these two fixed points. So this is the separatrix. And this region is the basin of attraction of this fixed point, whereas this region is the basin of attraction of this fixed point. And the idea is that if the initial conditions are anywhere in this region, the dynamics will eventually converge to this fixed point. Whereas if you start, if the cell starts at any point in this region, the dynamics will eventually converge to this fixed point. Now, this fixed point will correspond to the down state of the Purkinje cell. whereas this point will correspond to the up state of the Purkinje cells. So you can clearly see that this, now you can see why the model produces the bistability. Yeah. Okay, the separatrix as well, so the separatrix is, it was computed numerically, and if you want a technical, it's very simple to do it, but we can discuss the technical details later. But it's a very simple computation. So let's try and understand how, first let's try and understand the simple, yeah. Yeah, because, okay, if I have hyperpolarization of the cell will correspond, like a constantly hyperpolarizing the cell will correspond to moving this null cline up. So if I move this null cline up, then these two fixed points disappear. This is cell node bifurcation, and we are left only with this hyperpolarizing, hyperpolarized fixed point. So this will be the effect of constant hyperpolarization of the cell. More questions? So let's start with the easy things. What happens if we just take a cell in a depolarized state and hyperpolarize it? So transiently. If we hyperpolarize it sufficiently to cross the separatrix, then eventually the dynamics will converge to the down state. So this explains why hyperpolarization from an up state induced transition to a down state. This is easy. We don't need this complex thing to explain why hyperpolarization leads to hyperpolarization. Similarly, what will happen if we take a cell in a down state and depolarize it? Well, if this depolarization is sufficient to cross the separatrix, after the depolarization is terminated, the dynamics will converge to the up state. So this explains why depolarization from down induces transition to up. These are easy. But what happens if we have a sufficiently strong depolarization from up? So we depolarize the cell, it is depolarized, but while it is depolarized, the inactivation term turns off, the inactivation term inactivates, and if it inactivates sufficiently to cross the separatrix, once this input, this climbing fiber input, this complex spike, is turned off, there will be a rebound to a down state. So this rebound results from the fact that the depolarization was strong enough and long enough to inactivate the H current such that the separatrix is crossed here, and there is a transition to the up state. And a similar thing will happen if we hyperpolarize the cell from the down state. So we hyperpolarize it, but then the H term de-inactivates, and if it de-inactivates sufficiently to cross the separatrix here, once the current injection is turned off, then there'll be a rebound to an up state. So this is the mechanism that underlies this toggling effect in these Purkinje cells. Yes? The red line is the dH/dt null cline. I'll go back. Okay. The dynamics of the cell is described by two dynamic variables, V and H. And therefore, the state of the cell at any point in time can be described as a point in the HV phase plane. Okay? So I'm looking now only at the second equation. And I'm finding the solution where the dH/dt is equal to 0. If the dH/dt is equal to 0, this means that H is equal to H infinity of V. This is just the inactivation term. This is just this line. And similar thing for the line, the solution for dV/dt is equal to 0. Okay? How much time do I have? 30 minutes. Okay. This is not the whole story. Purkinje cells are more complicated, are much more complicated. And was mentioned earlier, there are things that are happening on a much longer time scale. So this is an example of in vitro recording. And what you see here are slow oscillations. In this case, the rate of oscillation is about, this is about, I think, 30 seconds. But sometimes it can be 50, 60 seconds, 2 minutes. We see very, very slow oscillations. And I'm sorry, no, this is spontaneous. Just put your electrode. And the mechanisms underlying these oscillations are not known. It's not really known what currents underlie these oscillations. And the question is, what will happen when we add this phenomenon, these very slow oscillations, to our model? And the way that we added it is by saying that whenever the cell is in, we added a very slow potassium current, and that inactivates whenever the cell, that activates whenever the cell is depolarized. And therefore, slightly moving this alkaline up, and inactivates whenever the cell is in a down state. These are very slow processes. And the idea is that it slowly moves the alkaline down, 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 until this fixed point disappears, and then the cell jumps to the other fixed point, and then the alkaline slowly moves up, and there will be a transition to the other fixed point, and so on. These things happen on a much longer time scale. And obviously, this reproduces spontaneous oscillations in the absence of any input. But more interesting for us, that they also reproduce the minority of cases in which climbing fiber input does not induce transitions. So as I told you, climbing fiber input induce transitions about 70% of the cases. And similarly, about 70% of the transitions are preceded by climbing fiber input. This is what we see in our data. If we add these very slow oscillations, then we get similar behavior. That is, sometimes, in minority of cases, there are spontaneous transitions, and sometimes there are complex spikes that don't do anything. So adding this longer time scale can also explain the failures. I will not go into the details, but the prediction of the model is that if we block H current, then the bistability will be retained, but the toggling phenomenon, the fact that we can induce transition in both directions, will disappear, because the H current is a rebound current that is responsible for the toggling phenomenon. And this we can do in vitro. This is an example of an in vitro recording. So this is toggling by high polarizing current pulse, inducing transition from down to up and from up to down. We block H current, the rebound disappears. The cell is bistable. We can induce a transition from down to up with depolarization and from up to down with high polarization. But we cannot induce transitions in both directions with the same current pulse. Yes? Obviously. The question, not for you or not for you, for the question for the cell, is not exactly how many currents or what currents it has, but what is the what class of dynamical systems it belongs. So, for example, you can take this cell model and change the parameters of the leak current or the H current or the persistent sodium current and move this alkaline here, and then the cell will only have an upstate or only have a downstate. Alternatively, you can generate the same thing with other currents. So it's not, if I have time, I will show an example how you, how not, not how other people have transformed a non-bistable cell into a bistable cell by blocking one conductance. Do I answer your question? No, but you gave up. I'm sorry? I don't know. It's an easy answer. Okay. Any questions about the mechanism? It is probably due to calcium-dependent potassium current, but there's no evidence. People have tried all kinds of things, but nobody really knows what underlies these very slow oscillations. Okay, this was the mechanism part, and now I will speculate about function. Everything that I'm going to say is really wild speculation, so you can leave the room if you like for this part. Many people believe that complex spikes code for error signals, and there are some experiments that support this idea. There are experiments which are done in the context of classical conditioning, in which you take a rabbit and you do an air path to the eye of the rabbit, and then you train it that the air path is conditioned on a tone. But if you just take a rabbit and have an air path to the eye of the rabbit, then you see complex spikes. These are rasters of complex spikes. But after the rabbit has learned the conditioning of tone to an air path, there will be no complex spikes, neither after the tone nor after the air path, or fewer. So this is one line of evidence that complex spikes code for error signal, for something unexpectedly bad that has happened to the animal. This is a different experiment. This is a cat walking on a treadmill. And from time to time, the limb is perturbed by an air path. And this is illustrated here. And whenever the leg is perturbed by an air path, people observe complex spikes. Note, however, that there are complex spikes at other times. But the fact that complex spikes are timed to the time of the air path or the time of the perturbation of the leg suggests that they code for an error signal, something bad, unexpected that happened to the animal. So our speculation is that the toggling in Purkinje cell in Purkinje cells may serve as a higher order reflex. There's an error. It is signaled by a climbing fiber input. So just do the opposite. If you were active, just stop the activity. If you were inactive, well, there was an error, something bad has happened, just do the opposite, start activity. So this could be, so the way that we see it is a kind of a higher order reflex. Just do the opposite. So to conclude this part of the talk, I've shown that the dynamics of Purkinje cells is bistable in vivo. That simple spike firing rate does not have a one-to-one correspondence to the instantaneous synaptic input. Climbing fiber input effectively modulates simple spike firing rate bidirectionally. And sensory modulation of simple spike firing rate may be mediated via the climbing fibers input. So now the question, I can't remember who asked the question about, what about awake behaving animals? And this is a very important question for people who are studying Purkinje cells. And there's a recent study by the group of Chris Dezel that claimed that our experiments show that bistability can only occur infrequently in awake animals. They did a study in which they, doing intracellular recordings in Purkinje cells in vivo in awake behaving animals is a technical challenge. And therefore, they tried to infer about the bistability of the cells from the firing pattern of simple spikes. They just did extracellular recordings. And what they've shown that there are significant changes in the firing pattern of these simple spikes, and therefore they concluded that there's no bistability in these cells. Or to be more accurate, they see bistability in only about 5 to 10% of their cells. I think that there is a lot of evidence in the literature, both supporting and both pro and against bistability. I will not go into the literature because I'm sure that most people here are not particularly interested in Purkinje cells. Just one example that I grabbed before I left from, this is unpublished data from the group of Dana Cohen in Bar-Ilan University, and asked her just, you know, she's doing a multi-unit recording from Purkinje cells in freely moving rats. I asked her, just give me one cell, and she gave me a cell. These are the spikes, and this is a histogram of the firing rate of the spike of this cell, and it's bimodal. Again, without doing intracellular recording, it's very difficult to say whether it is indeed reflecting the underlying bistability, but this is what we believe in. There are several differences. This is mice, this is rats, this is freely moving, these are restrained animals. I think that eventually what people will find out that bistability, the existence of bistability depends on the animal species and on the conditions. So in some conditions the cells are bistable, and in other conditions they are not. This is my guess. Second question for those of you who are not fans of Purkinje cells. Well, if you are not fans of Purkinje cells, you should start B because these are amazing cells. But still, if you are not convinced, what about cellular bistability in other brain structures? Apparently, it's pretty common. This is an example from spinal motor neurons. What they're doing here is they're recording the Merman potential as a function of the current injected. So they inject current, and the cell is depolarized, and then there is a jump. So the current needed to keep the cell at a more depolarized state is suddenly much smaller than the current that was needed here. And they go up. And then when they go down, there is this hysteresis, which is characteristic of membrane potential bistability. So there's bistability in motor neurons. And in fact, it shouldn't surprise you that there is bistability, because all you need for bistability is some kind of persistent inward current. For example, persistent sodium and persistent calcium. And as was mentioned here, these currents are all over the place. So in this example, these are thalamocortical neurons. H current was blocked, and the cell became bistable. So cells have capacity. I think almost all neurons have capacity for bistability. But the question of whether you will find bistability or will not find bistability depends on the exact values of the different conductances. And here you block one conductance, and you see the bistability. There are other examples, many examples for of bistability in invertebrates. I think going back to the 60s. No, what we need for our model for bistability is we only need the persistent inward current. We don't. The H current is important for the toggling. Okay, so cellular bistability is pretty common, and it's not surprising that it's common because you don't need much to produce it. But I'd like to go one to do one more level of abstraction. What really is needed for bistability? Let's forget about all these currents. All you need is some kind of positive feedback and saturation. And I'll explain it in the following case. So when the cell is hyperpolarized, this thing is turned off and the cell is in a down state. But if the cell is sufficiently depolarized, this conductance is turned on. Okay, it depolarizes the cell. So the conductance is further turned on until it saturates and we get the up state. And one can think of it in a more abstract way in the following function. So we have dvdt as a function of the Merman potential. When the cell is really hyperpolarized, the f of v is positive, so the cell is depolarized. When the cell is very depolarized, then this term is negative and the cell is hyperpolarized. And here there is some place there is positive feedback. If you cross this threshold, then the positive feedback leads you to the up state. And if you are just below the threshold, then you will just drift to the down state. So this is all is needed. This is the generic form of bistability. And therefore we would not be surprised if we see bistability in other bistability in the brain in other forms, not only cellular bistability, but also resulting from other dynamical processes. So this is an example of network-induced bistability in the cerebral cortex. So this is known as two states in the cortex. The cell has two states. It is either, this is a recording from a single neuron in the cell. It is either in a down state or in an up state. If you look at the histogram of the Merman potential, it's bimodal. But when a hyperpolarizing current pulse is injected, this histogram is just moved to the left. And the mechanism here, the mechanisms in the cortex for bistability in the cortex is that you have the whole cortical column, or maybe larger regions, are all coherently moved from up to down state. And the idea is that if all cells are quiescent, then they don't give excitatory input to other cells in the network, and therefore all cells are in a down state. But if sufficient number of cells become active, then they activate all their friends. There's a positive feedback leading to all cells going to the up state. So again, this positive feedback that leads to bistability. And interestingly, you can induce transition from down to up and from up to down with the same stimulus. In that case, this is just electric stimulation of the white matter in a slice. Previous examples were in vivo. And this electric stimulation induced transition from down to up and from up to down. Now, the mechanisms underlying this bidirectional, this toggling or bidirectional transition are not known, but I think conceptually, this framework can be helpful, this simple dynamical model. The question is now, what are these functions that generate this shape? What are these dynamical variables in the case of the network? But I think it's having a simple dynamical framework for toggling in one system can be helpful in understanding other systems. This is the beauty of understanding dynamical systems. So bistability we've seen cellular bistability, we've seen network bistability. Why be bistable? And I think that the thing about bistability or multistability is it generates long timescales. So the timescale of the Merman potential of this Purkinje cell is very short. I don't know, several tens of milliseconds. But still, these cells remember the history. So at this point in time, the cell remembers that 5 seconds ago, there was a hyperpolarizing current pulse. So although the intrinsic timescale of these neurons is very short, because of the bistability, they have a long-term memory on the order of many seconds. And people have suggested, so all is needed for biostability is some positive feedback, and positive feedback can be found in other processes. For example, this is an example of calcium-induced calcium release. So the idea that you have entry of the calcium to the cell, it triggers release of calcium from the endoplasmatic reticulum. We have, this is a positive feedback. So you may have, so the cell may have regions with calcium biostability, and several people, ourselves and people from RIKEN have suggested that this calcium biostability may underlie short-term memory in the brain. Similar thing about long-term memory. Think about synapses in the brain. The time scale of proteins in synapses is smaller than weeks, maybe days. Memories last for years. What are the mechanisms that enable this jump from this time scale to this time scale? And one possibility is bistable dynamics, which enhances the time scale. I don't have time to show any data. And the take-home message for you is, whatever field you are working in, I think you should keep your eyes open for bistability, because understanding that what you observe is a bistable system can give you a lot of insight to the underlying mechanisms. People that from dynamical systems, we know many things about the properties of bistable systems. So if you see something which looks bistable, you can learn quite a lot from understanding that it is bistable. And there's bistability in the molecular level. I did not have time to talk about it. Synaptic efficacy, I said a few words about. Subcellular compartments can be calcium dynamics or single dendrites that have several states. Membrane potential, Purkinje cell examples. Small networks, this is maybe the two states in the cortex, biostability in the cortex. And finally, even in perception, binocular rivalry is a bistable, can be thought of as governed by bistable dynamics. Finally, I would like to acknowledge the collaborators, my former advisors at the Hebrew University, Chaim Sompolinsky and Yossi Arom, and our collaborators at the University College London, in particular, Severin Mahon, that did many of the experiments that I described, and Michael Heuser. Thank you. Question, if I understand correctly, what about GABAergic input to Purkinje cells? I'm certain, first, we didn't do the experiments. Second, I'm certain that GABAergic input will induce transition from up to down in Purkinje cells. In order for, this is easy. Going from up to down with high polarization is easy. If the GABAergic input is sufficiently long, then it will also induce transition from down to up. But we haven't done the experiment, so I don't know. Yes, I think that, okay, so what about the parallel fibers input? I might have been too extreme and gave you the wrong view that 10 to the 5 or 10 to the 6 synapses to a Purkinje cells don't do anything. It's not true. I don't know what parallel fibers input does, but it is certainly important. I think in the anesthetized case, there's very little parallel fibers input, and therefore, we were able to see this phenomenon. In the wake, there will be parallel fibers input, and it can have two effects. First, if it is strong enough, it can induce transition from down to up. Second, it can modulate the firing rate in either of these two states. So if the cell is, it can modulate it both in up and in down, and I think that the gain will be very different. So the gain in up will be much smaller than the gain in down. So this is what I think that the parallel fibers input will do. Yes. I don't have any data which relates to behavior, except for the sensory stimulation. Therefore, I am reluctant to talk about what is better. Okay. What we know about Purkinje cells is, first, there are transitions on a long time scale, spontaneous transitions on a long time scale, time scales of tens of seconds. Whether they're biologically relevant, whether they're important, I don't know. On shorter time scales, there are transitions on at a rate, at least in rats, the rate is on the order of seconds, I think 1 second. I think in guinea pigs, the rate is lower. But even 1 second, you could argue that it's a pretty long timescale for a system which many people believe has to do with motor control. Many motor things, I'm moving my hands, it takes less than a second. So I believe, I have no data supporting it, that in vivo there are more inputs coming all the time, stronger excitatory input, stronger inhibitory input, and these inputs induce transitions from up to down and from down to up at a much higher rate, maybe at the rate of 10 hertz, on the order of 10 hertz. I would argue that the transitions that we see in awake behaving animals are triggered by synaptic input to these cells. That would be my guess. People suspect that it's a calcium-dependent potassium. There isn't much data. Not a lot is known, and I cannot comment more. I don't know. No, in my model, there's no spike-generating mechanism. So when I did not include a spike generating mechanism in the model, and the reason is that we see the same phenomena in the absence of spiking. So I don't think that it's crucial for the understanding of what's going on. Now the question, what would have happened if I had included the spike generating mechanism, I can only speculate. So first, we see, at least in our case, we see spiking only in the up state. So if you have depolarization in the up state, it will bring you back to the up state unless this depolarization is strong and long enough. So a complex spike is much longer than a simple spike. So you can have spikes in the up state, simple spikes, which you will go back, you'll stay in the up state. But when you have a complex spike, which is longer, it is sufficient to hyperpolarize, to inactivate the H current to go to the down state. So I think that this would not be a problem for the toggling. So it's definitely not a problem for the bistability, and I don't think that it will be also that it will be a problem for the toggling, because the spikes are much shorter. Yes. It is generally believed that complex spikes carry, no, but not by everybody, not by everybody in the field, but by many people, that indeed complex spikes carry error signals. There is some data. In my opinion, it is not strong enough, so I don't know what complex spikes code for. I find it difficult to believe that they code for error signals, in particular because you see them all the time. Even there's spontaneous complex spike activity. Assuming that indeed they code for error signal, the way that we think about it is something bad happened, do the opposite. That's what they tell you. This will be the first order chain. Then later they will affect learning and plasticity, but you know, just stop doing whatever you were doing now and do the opposite. That's my view, my very simplistic view on what the complex spikes do. Okay, so the question is, LTD in the cerebellum is known to be also LTP by the timing of complex spikes and simpler spikes. And the question is, how is it related with the data that I've shown? So first, plasticity takes place on a much longer time scale. So this is something which can be complete, which can be separate and independent from what I've shown. You need many stimulations in order to see the effect. Whereas what I've shown is that one complex spike have affects the firing of the cell for the next half a second. But what will happen 10 seconds from now is 10 seconds from now, you will not know whether it was a complex spike or not. I would like to speculate. I'd like to speculate that in fact, what is important for the plasticity is the occurrence of complex spike while there is calcium in the cell. It's not a simple spike, it is calcium in the cell. And there is the calcium concentration, I believe that the calcium concentration, I don't have data, but have supporting evidence, that the calcium concentration in the upstate is much larger than the calcium concentration in the downstate. So I think that the effect of the plasticity, the effect of complex spike on plasticity, on potentiation of the parallel fiber synapses will depend very much on whether complex spike happened in an upstate or happened in a downstate. Did I answer your question? Yes. No. I think that the results that I've shown you are only dependent on the biophysical properties of the Purkinje cell, a single Purkinje cell. So this Purkinje cell doesn't really care what generated the complex spike, whether it was this kind of stimulation or that kind of stimulation. It's a very simple element, has very simple dynamics. All it cares about, there was a complex spike, there wasn't a complex spike, I'm in up, I'm in down, that's all. For functional purposes, I really don't know what's the function of this bistability or toggling. I can only speculate, and my speculation is as good or maybe worse than yours. more questions? Stop.